This video is sponsored by Blinkist. About a week and a half ago, I uploaded a video about why I haven't quit my day job, even though my YouTube channel is a solid source of revenue now. I was surprised that that video performed decently well, but I did get a lot of comments asking me how I managed to make both things work, how I managed to work a full-time day job as a software consultant and also churn out a decent number of YouTube videos every week. Not every video is like this big hero effort, but some of the videos are. The one that released just a few days ago, the one on quitting social media, being a movie, the Coen Brothers director series video. That one was around 3 weeks worth of footage that we had just been acquiring and then finally turned into a hopefully epic presentation. And I've been making these videos all while still working a day job. And now that the city has opened up just slightly with regards to quarantine restrictions and all that, I have on occasion been hanging out with friends, still making time to visit my parents twice a week. And at times it does seem like a decent amount to be juggling, but I have a handful of principles that I sort of think about and adhere to try to get everything done. And in this video, I want to share those ideas with you. There's 9 principles I'm going to be covering. There's timestamps for each of them. Look at how Ali Abdal I'm starting to become. It's true. He's changed my life. Thank you for teaching me about the joys of timestamping, Ali. Anyway, here are the 9 principles. Number 1, I don't work 40-hour weeks in the day job. Okay, I know that sounds unethical or potentially bad, but the truth is the corporate world has enormous inefficiencies and redundancies in it. Now, don't get me wrong. There are definitely weeks where things get very intense. I have a project deadline or some deliverable to meet to make a client happy. And there have definitely been days where I work from 7 a.m. to like 9 p.m. to try to get those deadlines met. But luckily my company, it's a fantastic company and they don't micromanage, you know, watching my hours. I've been a remote worker even before the pandemic. And it had been a goal of mine to become a fully remote worker so that I could have more control over my time and so that I could try to be as efficient with my time as possible. I don't have to waste time commuting or making it look like I'm working when in reality, all of my work, all of the stuff that might need to get done that day is done. So I work instead by completing the highlight of my day, both for work and for YouTube, as opposed to making it seem like I'm working a full 40 hours. And the truth is there's been a lot of research done on how many hours people work at work. And for most people, it's far less than 40 hours. I had read this in a book called The Productivity Project, I believe by Chris Bailey. And he pointed to how much people overestimate the amount of hours they're putting in. And the more people say they're working, so if anyone says they work like 60 hours a week or 70 hours a week, in reality, they're like off by like 20 hours or more. I think the average employee who is billing 40 hours a week of work only works between 26 and 32. I'm not gonna pretend that I work 40 hours a week when so many people don't. I sort of just acknowledge that that comes with the territory. And there's also been other research on deep work, which is really the most important work you could be doing as a knowledge worker in the 21st century. According to Cal Newport, we only have around 3 or 4 hours a day where we can do truly cognitively demanding deep work, where we're really stretching our brain to get tasks done. That's why when I was in my early career and one of my first job titles in digital marketing was SEO specialist at a big Fortune 1000 company, Thomson Reuters, a lot of my job was just checking URLs, checking to see if hyperlinks worked. It was so mundane, and just in that whole process, there were so many inefficiencies. And so now that I work from home and my time is largely my own, I try to cut out those inefficiencies as much as possible. And in order to accomplish this, I work not by hours, but by completing the highlight of my day. On most days, I have one highlight of the day to complete for YouTube and one highlight of the day to complete for my day job. And each of those things on any given day only takes 1 to 3 hours. And yet they're such crucial things to complete that if I complete them over the course of a week and over the course of a month, I am accomplishing enough tasks to sort of stay on pace with things. And just saving those hours makes both jobs, YouTube and the day job, more possible. In this regard, there's a second principle called Pareto's principle that I operate on, which is to say that 80% of your results come from 20% of your actions. This is a very famous principle by a man named Pareto. So what are the handful of tasks, what are the key result areas that are the most important thing with work and with YouTube? With my day job, there's 2 kinds of things that I do that are valuable, and everything else is not valuable at all. So meetings are not valuable. People delude themselves into thinking meetings are valuable. They're pretty much never valuable. Anything that I've ever accomplished in a meeting over 2 years of work could just be like a quick little email, honestly, just a couple of bullet points. And then we wouldn't have to have 12 consultants all on this Zoom call. Our clients often pay $200 per hour per person. So some of these calls, which are not very efficient, are costing a client like $2,000 or $3,000 just for an hour of people getting together and getting aligned on things. What is important is simply the completion of tasks, the completion of Jira tickets. And with software, there's a lot of complications with completing things that seem mundane, but often are hard to implement. Things like adding the right button to an email so that it looks just right, so that when a customer finds their email, they can click on that link and everything works perfectly. Or putting together the perfect landing page. Or tasks like giving people the right amount of access. Data security is a huge part of my job. It seems very tedious at times because I have no interest in hijacking your company information on I don't know if I'm allowed to say that. Anyway, but the completion of those tickets, if I get one or two tickets done in a day, that's actually huge. So that's one of my key result areas at work, just getting one or two tickets done. The other thing is sometimes I don't have a client. Like for the last month, all of May, I have not had a client. So I haven't had any billable hours this month. In times like that, what the company expects of me as a consultant is to do a lot of self-education, keep learning, and to get more certifications. The more certifications I get, the more qualified I become as a consultant. And then that's how promotions also work in our company, is through managing clients and gaining certs. 2 weeks ago, I had gained a cert and I'm currently studying for my third certification. So with this last month, since I can't do client work, I have been focusing on the other key result area. And in this regard, even though 40-hour weeks aren't being put in, I am being valuable to the company, if that makes sense. With YouTube, things get really complicated. A lot of people are like, oh, what video do I make? Oh, what do I do? But really, around 80% of the value of this job comes from writing out a script and doing this, talking it into a camera. There's a lot of creativity we try to infuse now, but for the most part, this is 80% of the job. Even the big guys like Peter McKinnon, Matt D'Avella, the big guys in MySpace anyway, they're of course doing a lot of different things. They're going on locations, they're talking about different ideas, they're crafting a visual story to explain their ideas. MKBHD, if you break it down, what are they doing? They're just talking to a camera. And so I tell myself to get rid of so many expectations of myself with, oh, what do we do today? What is the focus of today? Hey, just talk to a camera. That's the Pareto principle, being honored with the channel. Does it ever happen to you that you want to read a book, but you just don't have the time? I have been using Blinkist for quite some time now, and it's what I use to get book summaries. I especially use it when I want to research a book and see if it's worth my time. You can get the best insights from 4,500 nonfiction books, which condenses them into just 15 minutes. You can read or listen to them podcast style. So if I'm ever doing the dishes or doing the laundry, I can just listen to a book and get the ideas there and then go back into writing after based off what I've heard. There's full length audiobooks, and premium subscribers get special member pricing up to 65% off of the regular retail price. A book that I might recommend is Thinking Fast and Slow, because the actual book is just incredibly long and dense, and the summary gives you a lot of the main takeaways. It's just a book about when we should apply quick thinking, like quick decision making, and when we should really think through our process on something. And especially with things like YouTube or even my day job, I need both kinds of thinking all the time, especially if we're making one of our director series videos and we need to just get things on the fly. I'm using a lot of fast thinking, but there's also a lot of times where I need to kind of deeply ponder something and have a strategy for making a decision. So I've really loved that book, and I especially have loved my Blinkist summary of that book. The first 100 people to go to the link in my description box will get unlimited access for a week to try out Blinkist. You'll also get 25% off if you want the full membership. The third principle is fire, then aim, then refire. Fire before you aim. Getting promotions at my day job, or seeming like I'm bringing value to my manager and to my clients, like I said, comes down to two things: completing tickets and gaining certifications. When I'm trying to complete tickets, I try not to muck about just troubleshooting or figuring things out on my own. In fact, my framework often is, can I find the answer on Google? If not, is there someone in the company who has done this task before, and just can I get them on a call to help me figure this thing out? And I think I save between 4 and 20 hours per ticket just because I try not to troubleshoot. I try to avoid troubleshooting completely. Of course, sometimes this is unavoidable. I have to go back, learn how to solve a problem, then implement the solution, and then figure out, you know, why something might not be working, what kinks there are. But this is my framework. Why try to reinvent the wheel when there might be someone else who can just give me the answer? And I think that's the key to knowledge work today, is find the person who already has the answer and get the answer from them if you can. Unfortunately, my managers, my colleagues are just so supportive and helpful that if they can make the time, so often, like different developers and stuff have just gotten on a call with me and helped me with my tickets and helped me get through something. And then I can gain the experience to do it alone the next time. But one of my rules is just troubleshoot as little as possible. With certifications, I also practice this principle of firing first and then aiming and then refiring. In the sense that when I'm trying to get a new certification, what I do is just schedule the exam and take the exam. Just this last Friday, I took an exam for Salesforce Platform App Builder, and I didn't study for that exam at all. You need a 65% to get a Salesforce exam. I got 42% without any studying, so I failed it. But then what I did is like a brain dump, where I just try to remember every question, everything that I encountered. And luckily with Salesforce, they break down your scoring by section. So because I'm decent at Salesforce fundamentals, I scored well on that category, and also mobile apps. And then there were three sections where I scored quite low, but I can go back and I know what sections I'm weak on. And also because I did this mind dump right after taking the exam, I can just go back and look at those questions that I remembered. I had all these things I encountered and then I wrote them down. So now I'm actually gonna go back and study, but I'm studying having already taken the exam. I already know I'm going to save so much time when I go back in and take the exam again, because it's not like this big monster that's in front of me, the next Salesforce exam, and I'm just meticulously studying every detail of every component of this exam. No, a lot of that mental pressure is off now. I've already taken the exam. I got a 42%. I just need an extra 23% to pass it. So I'm just gonna study those sections and get it. So that's what I mean by fire, then aim. Same thing with this YouTube channel. I found that instead of deliberating which video should I make, this video or that video, just whichever idea comes to me first, just make the video and upload it, like as quickly as possible. Try to leave as little gap between coming up with an idea and executing on that idea. And then if the video tanks, okay, that's information that I wouldn't have otherwise. And if it succeeds, then I also know that, okay, this style of content, this packaging of this video, this title, thumbnail, and video length, it works. That's valuable information. Recently, I uploaded a video where I just interviewed my mom. It was like my best video in weeks. I was shocked. I did not know that so many people would love to see my mom roast me for 17 minutes, but turns out that's great content.
But you're disappointed a little bit that I'm not a doctor, right?
Yeah.
That has opened up my brain to so many more video ideas, and it also was fun to shoot an interview style video with a 3-camera setup. We were still able to exercise our skills with lighting and editing, but in a simple interview style video. Fire, then aim, then refire. Principle number 4, use checklists to ensure quality. With YouTube today, I think it looks so different than what YouTube might've looked like 5 or 6 years ago, and it's all about quality. It's better to upload fewer videos that are high quality than to be uploading all the time. You don't wanna clog people's feeds with a lot of low quality content. But that's the tough part. Where does quality come from? To a lot of people, just a angry David Goggins video shot in vertical off his cell phone is way more valuable than all the high production stuff that a lot of other YouTubers make now. And the same thing could go for my video. Some videos are more valuable than others. Sometimes the sketches are more valuable. Sometimes the talking heads where I'm just being honest and genuine are more valuable. Sometimes when I do a lot of research, it's more valuable. Sometimes when the visuals are great, that's higher quality. I really can never know. It's very hard to predict where quality comes from, but I use checklists to get as close to quality as possible. And Thomas, my videographer, and I, we have like a workflow where we go through a sequence of events between shooting an A-roll, shooting B-roll, adding sound design, adding the right songs, using graphic overlays. And when each of those components is addressed in a systematic way, then I can get towards quality faster, and I don't have to be trapped in my head as much about getting quality. Which brings me to the next principle, delegate. Now, I used to hate when productivity books would talk about delegation back in the day because I didn't have any money up until age 26. And now it feels like, okay, this is the first year where I have a disposable income. And so now I delegate. Now a lot of the work is shared between me and Thomas. So if you're watching this and you're not in a place where you can think, how do I delegate tasks? You know, I completely understand. Maybe this is not a principle that applies to you, but it's definitely a huge, huge part about how I'm able to manage both things is the fact that I have someone working with me on the channel. The 6th principle is to become more skilled by being consistent. So I'm a few years into the game of making YouTube videos and now have 2 years of experience at this position as a software consultant. And one of the reasons I'm able to manage my time better and also produce higher quality work in both terrains is that I'm just more skilled because I've been doing it for a little bit. So a lot of the stuff that I would make now would take me way longer to make at the same level of quality like a year ago or 2 years ago especially. And it's an idea that I got from the Vlog Brothers that you should actually not completely focus on quality, but focus on quantity, just the quantity of output and regularly showing up to a good degree, kind of like 80%, not going all the way, like not putting everything you have into one thing, because it's kind of easy to get to 80% quality. Getting those last 20% is like pretty hard just because it's stretching your skill levels, which is great, of course, but you often get bogged down trying to get those last 20%. And the thing is, a year from now, your 80% then is gonna be way past your 100% today. We've been making these director series videos for almost a year now. In August, we made our first one last year, which was like a Christopher Nolan style parody video. That one was really hard to make because we had never made one of those before. And now, recently, the video that came out a few days ago, being the 8th director series video, I just know that I'm able to pull that story together so much more quickly. I'm able to create the shot list, and even while on location, find the right shot much faster. An example is that Coen Brothers video has a shot of me trying to dig. There's like some digging footage that's supposed to be there early on because this character is burying his phone as a symbolic gesture of not being on social media anymore. And the first shots that we got for it, the shot we had planned on it, was shot from far away on a telephoto lens. And to me, somehow that image just looked a little flat, but it was a cold, rainy day. We didn't want to be out in the field for too long. And so I realized that maybe switching to a wide lens and focusing on some tall grass that had grown nearby, shooting from there and having me be blurry in the background might create more depth in the shot. I'm not sure if this is something I'd be able to come up with on the spot a year ago, but I saw it that day on the field and you can look at the shots yourself. I think you can tell that one just gives off more of a sense of depth and scope. And the flatter shot, the telephoto shot, just looks a little more amateur by comparison. There's just a quality that you get when you're in the field so often, when you do something consistently day in and day out, where you just become more effective at it. So one of the greatest time management principles ever is to just show up to work every day because you will become more efficient. Principle number 7 is calendar blocking, weekly planning, and batching. Because I only have one highlight for every day, what I've started doing is picking out my highlight of the day for the whole week on Sunday evening, and then I calendar block my whole day. I've been doing this for a little bit now, and I think I'm gonna make a video about calendar blocking for a whole month, because just having that rough idea of what that day should look like allows me to schedule in more work and also more play. Like, I schedule in time to go to a baseball game, hang out with friends, holding myself accountable for also scheduling in like my relationship time, which as I get older, I realize it's like a really important place to invest in your life. And so if this isn't something you do, or you think this might like stress you out, just try this one thing of finding a day every week. For me, it's Sunday, and just making a calendar block for that whole week, and especially choosing a highlight of the day for each day of that week. If you do this for a week and you get your highlight of the day done, that one thing done every day for the whole week, you'll be blown away by just how satisfied you are with that whole week. Principle number 8 are two apps that I really love, Productive and Todoist. I'm not a big advocate of like apps, you know, I'm not an app kind of guy, like especially with productivity and stuff, but these are two that I have enjoyed using. Productive is a habit tracker, and now I have just reduced my number of habits I focus on to just two things, which is my workout and my highlight of the day. I think simplicity is incredibly powerful, and there's a real satisfaction with just swiping right on Productive and just seeing that you got a habit done. And then it allows you to make and build a streak, and the longer that streak goes, the more you feel like getting your key result areas done. I think that's actually a subscription plan, so I don't know if it's worth it for you, but I just love the interface of Productive, so it might be one you wanna check out, you know, not sponsored by Productive. The other one is Todoist. That is more of a checklist type app, and so my specific tasks for that week, I'll just make on Todoist on a Sunday night. Over the course of a week, I'll try to get as many done as I can. And if on any given day, I'm just kind of like sitting there stumped, I don't know what to do with myself, that occasionally happens, my hope is I open up Todoist and I see, oh, okay, what can I get done on here? Because if I'm not doing anything, I might as well try to get one of these things done. Getting things done feels better than just mindlessly consuming stuff. So those are two apps that I find really helpful. And the final principle is Parkinson's law, which I also pair with this idea of taking no days off. Parkinson's law says that the amount of time we take in completing any task will expand or contract to the amount of time we have. So if I say I need to get this done in 2 days, I will take the whole 2 days to get it done. And if I tell myself I have a whole week, I'll take a whole week. Like, I will just fill up that time. So I might as well just give myself less time because it will get done. So I use these mental models all the time where I say, okay, this month we're gonna make 8 videos and it gets done. You know, like if I say that's the goal and I just keep that as a target, I get those videos done. And I often tell myself, oh, I should upload less because the quality is gonna drop off if I upload too much. And in reality, the quality rarely drops off. Like, there is a quality bar that we don't miss just because of who we are. Parkinson's law is pretty helpful. So if you just tell yourself, okay, this is the target for this month, make it kind of a little aggressive so you give yourself less time than you might think is ideal, you'll be surprised by how much you fit in just because it was supposed to get done. So anyway, these are the 9 principles that help me stay on task, get things accomplished, and still also have a somewhat thriving social life. Parkinson's law, Productive and Todoist, calendar blocking, becoming more skilled by staying consistent, delegation, checklists, firing then aiming, Pareto's principle, and working by the highlight of the day. These are my 9 principles for getting things done. That's it for today. Greatness is coming, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Cheers.